1518.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right? No, no. Six. Wait a minute.
See, MDC, 16.
1613.
Right. Okay. All right. Practically a modern book.
This book is ready. I need the.
A little bit more.
Yeah, I need
of
a little
cloth.
More for just buffing.
Okay. There we go.
Since this part is paper, you do nothing with it except dust it the first day.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm doing now is buffing the
vellum. Oh, indeed. Look at the shine.
See the shine come up? Mm-hmm. It's had two treatments with saddle soap.
Mm-hmm.
There. See it shine? Isn't that nice?
Now that really is pretty, and it's stamped in gold and
yes.
black. That really makes a handsome volume. They don't do it that way anymore. I've noticed very few vellum books coming
in. That's right.
House.
Then I have to look for the card and put it where it will show so the librarian can shelve it.
That's right. We protected the card at the start, as I recall, by dipping it down in.
There it is.
There you go. Yes, 1613.
Bellarmino Roberto Francesco. There we are, ready to be shelved. And then I have two here that I will show you that have been shelved and that were finished. One that is all vellum.
Mm-hmm.
And we tie vellum so it doesn't buckle.
This, by the way, is the proverbial red tape.
That's right.
People have heard of red tape. Well, now you're seeing some. In fact, Mary is in a position to cause a great deal of trouble. She has a whole roll of it here. So if there's
That's
anything
right.
you want to stop, you can go and
I
tie it up. Right? This is red tape. Turns out it's been used for centuries for purposes like this, tying up documents. And so when people say there's a lot of red tape, they mean there are a lot of documents tied up.
And now we use it when we talk about bureaucracies, don't we?
That's right. That's right.
That one has already been shelved. We just brought it down to show you what it looked like.
And it really gets to be pretty.
And here's an all-leather one that has been shelved.
I've got to touch.
All right.
You are allowed to touch here at the Rare Book Room.
Yes,
of course,
we are.
You have to get by all the guards out there and so forth and the dogs. But once you're in here, you're allowed to touch.
No dogs, David.
Oh. I must have been a bit of statuary. Fooled me there. Very nice.
Here's an all-leather one that is finished.
These are papal epistles, right? Looks like it.
Right. This is the history of the wars of Flanders. Look at that lovely printing.
Gee.
Look at the border on it, on all the pages. The Wars of Flanders. And Wars is spelled here with one R, but over here with two. Why is that? Is that just a typo?
Looks like a typo to me. One of the things I love about old books is that as you're turning the page, they give you the first word of the next line.
The next page, right?
So while you're turning, you can keep in mind where you're
that.
Then it says that they came
right.
to raise by fourth. You also have this trouble reading that they came to rafe by fourths.
Yes,
all the S's
those
that S's, look like F's.
Those old-fashioned German S's, yes.
I always feel that I'm lisping. This is when I knew Evelyn Wood was right, because when you read an old book, you start hearing all these F's in your head, and she's right, we're hearing those words,
yes.
We shouldn't do that. Actually, I like hearing the words, so nuts to Evelyn, I read slow.
I see.
Well, those are beautiful, Mary, and that's really kind of rewarding. You've been coming for 2 years to do books.
Isn't that nice?
And all your neighbors think that you're mixed up somehow or other with dirty books.
Yes.
They're not wrong.
Well, that's what I say. They say, why can't you come Thursday afternoon? I say, oh, I clean dirty books on Thursday afternoon.
I think you should get trickier and say, I'm tied up with dirty books.
Oh, that's pretty good.
That.
That's a good way to put it.
Or I devote my Thursday afternoons to dirty books.
Oh, that's even better.
That's even better. Well, that's what Mary does on some of the Thursday afternoons of her life. Very good. Mary, it was a nice break to watch you fix books, and now we're going to come back to something you said earlier. You mentioned that you didn't mind teaching in an all-black school because, after all, your family was immigrants, and back in Ohio, you had been teaching people of all descriptions.
Right.
Tell me a little bit about your family.
Well, my father came over in the great wave of immigration in 1908.
From?
Yugoslavia. Which was then the Austro-Hungarian Empire.
That's right.
Before the First World War. And when he left Yugoslavia, he told my mother, who was then 13, that someday he'd bring her over.
And he was 13?
He was 20.
Oh, he was 20.
No, he was 20.
And she was 13.
And he was 6 or 7 years older than she was. Since I wasn't there, I don't quite remember what the story is. Anyhow, he brought her over in 1913.
6 years later.
Yes. And he came in 1908. He brought her over in 1913, and they were married in Pennsylvania.
And his occupation?
And he worked in the steel mills. In a lot of immigrants, you see, worked in the steel mills. It was immigrants, after all, who developed this country, wasn't it?
Well, they had to do, and they could do the work. You didn't necessarily have to know English.
No, most of them didn't know English. And when we left Pennsylvania and moved to Ohio, my mother said to my father that he must find us a house in an American neighborhood. We have to learn to speak English. When we came to Canton, my brother and I could not speak English. And in 1 year, my mother says, we were not speaking Croatian.
Anymore.
We were speaking English.
Well, then how old were you then?
I must have been about three.
Okay.
Three or four.
How's your Croatian now, Mary?
Oh, it's pretty good, but my grammar isn't good. I grew up in a bilingual home.
Okay.
And I've been to Yugoslavia to visit all my relatives are in Yugoslavia except my mother.
Now, you tell me why he moved from... this has to do with your sort of being a stalwart of the Democratic Party, I have the feeling. Why did your father move from Pittsburgh?
Well, when he was in Pittsburgh, he didn't like the way the workers were treated. They worked long hours in a hot steel mill. And the workers tried to organize a union. My father was blacklisted for trying to organize a union for the workers.
So he was not only fired, but nobody in town would hire him.
That's right. So we moved to Ohio, to a steel town, Canton, Ohio. And he got a job in the steel mill in Canton and proceeded to do something to better the conditions of the working man, and he was blacklisted again. So then he decided that he would open his own business and be his own boss. So he opened a men's clothing store in a neighborhood not far from a Croatian colony in Canton, Ohio, and not far from the steel mill. And on payday, the steel workers came to my father's store to cash their payroll checks.
Mm-hmm.
And on payroll day, either my mother or I would go to the, we lived across the street from the store, would go over and help my father in what would be about an hour's rush.
Yes, everybody was there and
yes.
You had to do all this?
Yes. And it was Labor Day weekend on a Saturday, August 31st, 1929. And while we were in there waiting for men to come with their payroll checks, two young men came in and on the pretense of buying a hat. When my father turned around to open the hat case, they both pulled little guns from their pockets. And I nudged my father, and he turned around, and we both stood there like a couple of ninnies. We were simply petrified. And they shot my father across the counter and killed him instantly, and they ran.
Right in front of you?
Right in front of me. I lived in a nightmare for months.
Did they get anything?
Nothing at all. And almost at the same moment that my father was killed, across town, a man was held up on the street with a factory payroll, and he was shot and killed and robbed.
And it was payday, so if they
yes.
had come later,
yes.
presumably the people would have been there.
Yes, it was almost time for the men to come into my father's shop. And as a matter of fact, they came before all the excitement was over. I don't know who came in. Somebody did, because I ran out and screamed. Somebody came in, and they lifted him up, and I'll never forget this, they lifted him up and laid him on piles of men's trousers. And our family doctor was there. I don't know how he got there, but he did. And they didn't think my father would live, and he didn't. They opened his shirt, and he had been shot through the abdomen, and there wasn't a speck of blood on his body. The damage was all internal.
Mm-hmm.
And he died almost immediately.
So then your family was...